Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. In this episode, I'm going to talk about C++ 26's concat view. On the surface, this is going to seem very simple, but I assure you that it does have a few twists and turns that make it interesting, and you should stick through this episode to see what that's all about. My name is Jason Turner. I am available for code reviews and on-site training, and you should check out this video description for sponsor links and other upcoming events. Let's start with something pretty mundane, I guess. Unfortunately, we don't have a compiler plus standard library combination that supports both C++ 26's concat and C++ 23's ranges print functionality. It's a thing, so you're just going to have to bear with me here with a little bit uglier code than I would prefer to write. I've just created two 4-integer arrays. They don't need to be the same size, so just for the sake of not being overly confusing here, I will go ahead and make them two different sizes. I find this particular utility very interesting because this is something that I wanted like the very first time that I used ranges, but it wasn't a thing, and now it is a thing, so that's cool. I'm concatenating A2 and A1 together. Yeah, I just regressed to IO streams, but it's a thing. They do still exist and they are part of the standard still. As you might observe, I concatenated these in the opposite order of what you might have expected, and we can see that I have actually printed them out in the order that the concatenation determined. If I wanted to, I can make this mutable as well, and I might do something like this, where I'm actually transforming this thing or mutating it in some way if I were so inclined. It's agnostic to the type of container that I happen to be using. So I can go ahead and put this vector in here, and if I wanted to, I could do something like this. And I've got A2, V, A1, and now I can loop over these things and do the thing. Now I am printing A2, V, A1. Where things get particularly interesting here is the fact that the properties of the underlying iterator are maintained with this concat view. I'll show you what I mean. In this function on line 6, I've got two different vectors, and I am concatenating them, and then I am going to index into the 10th element and set that equal to the value 10. Because these are both random access iterators, I'm able to concatenate them and maintain the random accessibility of the underlying data. I have no idea what this assembly is going to look like, so let's go ahead and figure this out real quick. I have this update function, and it's loading pointers to, let's see, RDI and RDI plus 8. That is the first container. It seems to be checking to see if the first container is empty, so it's looking at RDI and RDI plus 8. That's probably going to be the begin and end. And then it's doing a comparison, and if they are empty, then it'll jump off somewhere. Then it's checking to see if the size of this thing is at least 40 bytes, basically, because that is 4 times 10, and I am looking at the 10th element. If I were to set this to 11, I expect to see this comparison go to 44. And I was right. So if it's going to go past the end of the first vector, then it's going to jump down here to L14, where it will index into the second vector by some number of elements, some computed thing, and can potentially do this update back to line 12. So then it's going to set the appropriately loaded value here and return from the function. All right, I think this makes some sense. Yeah, if the first container is not empty, then it's going to compute the offset there. Right, so this is actually pretty straightforward. I mean, at least as far as we could hope for it to be in the efficient generated code, there's a few comparisons, conditionals, jumps in here. It's going to be a little bit of extra pressure on the branch predictor unit than we might have hoped, but I don't think this is any worse than what we would have written by hand. And I find this really interesting. Let's go ahead and take this to the next level. And I'm going to add a list in here. List is not random access iterable. I can still concatenate these things together. I can still print these values out. But if I wanted to try to concat a list and a vector and then do a random access into that, that really should not work. And I'm guessing that we're going to see a very ugly compile error. Unfortunately, probably not something that is going to be very easy to understand. So that did work. Now I'm going to change the second thing to a list of int, and we're going to see what kind of compile error we get on line 8. All right, no match for operator, bracket, index operator, operator, and types of concat view, blah, 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 and int required from here. So this really doesn't tell us what went wrong. Some constraints were not satisfied. And if we know what we're looking for, we'll see that it doesn't have random access range. This is something that you're going to have to be aware of when you're using views and then want to do something like random access with them. Not something that you'll be able to figure out from the list of compiler errors that you got. But either way, I hope you found this to be an interesting episode. I can definitely see how concat could really be useful when you have data from disparate sources and then want to do one series of operations on it, a skip or a filter or whatever you would want to do. Again, thanks for watching this episode. Be sure to subscribe. I'll catch you in the next one.